We do thank you for that blessed position that we enjoy in your beloved Son. We thank you for your word that gives to us that assurance, that spiritual confidence, knowing that we are forever yours. We pray that our time and study of your word, especially here as we continue in 1 Corinthians, would, as always, be enlightening. May we have a better grip regarding who you are, what you're doing, what your expectations are of the believer today, and may we certainly take heed to the exhortation and the admonition that we're going to be examining here in chapter 10. Again, may all things redound to the glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is worthy of it all. Amen. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We are going to resume where we left off last Sunday morning. What we did last Sunday morning is identify in the opening verses five specific provisions in relationship to the nation of Israel. We're not going to review the context. You know the context right now. The context has to do with liberty, the right use or right application of liberty. That's the thrust of chapters 8, 9, and 10. And as you know, the Corinthians are in danger of misapplying liberty. Instead of serving one another, use not liberty for the occasion of the flesh, but by love serve one another. The Corinthians were in danger now of exercising liberty for their own personal self-gratification, so on and so forth. So chapter 8, we learned about the principle of liberty. Chapter 9, we learned about Paul being the picture of liberty. Chapter 10, we're examining the practice of liberty, specifically the danger that lurks for the believer today if we're not practicing or applying grace in a proper manner. In other words, we're actually looking at a negative aspect to the practice of liberty. In the opening verses, we see the practice of liberty that ends up in spiritual catastrophe. Okay, so in light of the context liberty, what Paul is doing in the opening verses is he's demonstrating that even though a believer might possess blessings and privilege and advantage, that is not a guarantee that one will, quote, succeed spiritually, okay? So kind of like what he writes there at verse 12. Look at chapter 10, verse 12. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. So be careful. Do you have liberty? Absolutely. But be careful. There is an inherent danger. Liberty that is never applied properly will result in a fall. Spiritually speaking, that doesn't mean you're going to hell or anything like that, okay? So, with that in mind, let's read the opening verses again and just sort of recognize what Paul is doing here by going back to Israel's history. Now, remember, it all begins with, hey, I'm free to eat meat. Well, I'm free to sit in that temple to eat that meat dedicated to whatever god or goddess. And then ultimately, the inherent danger is you may revert back to your old religious habits. And that is an inherent danger. I'm free to eat the meat. I'm free to attend that temple and sit there publicly enjoying that meat. And then you could end up going back to the system that you were delivered out of. And that is part of what Paul's doing here. All right, so verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers, remember, Paul's now talking about history. He's talking about his identity with the nation of Israel. Paul, of course, was an Hebrew of the Hebrews. He was of the tribe of Benjamin. He was a Pharisee, so on and so forth. Paul is not suggesting that you and I, by default, are spiritual Israelites. Therefore, we would call Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and you know, all these Old Testament fathers, our fathers. Paul's now thinking like a Jew. Okay? Do you remember what we read in chapter 9? Verse 20, and unto the Jews I became as a what? Jew. So he's thinking like a Jew now, and he's deliberately taking the Corinthians back in history. And Paul, he's talking about his identity as a Jew, okay? He is not suggesting that we, again, are spiritual Israelites, okay? Remember chapter 12, verse 2, critically important. Ye know that ye were Gentiles, okay? So the audience, they're Gentile. So when we read in verse 1, moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our, again, Israel's fathers, were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for that they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Okay, why is Paul doing this? Okay, you Corinthians are on the verge of committing the same mistake that the nation of Israel committed in history past, okay? Israel enjoyed a number of different provisions, a number of different blessings and advantages, and yet, what happened? Look there at verse 8. Neither let us commit fornication as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. Think about this. They had all of these spiritual benefits, and what happened? 23,000 of them are slain. So, enjoying blessing is no guarantee of success. Historically, it didn't help these 23,000 Israelites that were cut down in the wilderness. So Paul, by way of parallel, he's going to be stressing the point that, wait, we too today, as members of the body of Christ in the dispensation of grace, we too, we also enjoy various provisions, advantages, and blessings. So, is that a guarantee that we are always going to succeed? Remember verse 12 again, wherefore let him that thinketh he stand take heed lest he what? We are in possession of some glorious provisions and blessings, and yet, is it possible for a believer today to fall? And remember, when Paul uses the word fall, that has nothing to do with losing your soul and ending up in the lake of fire, okay? Falling from that position and place, our identity, enjoying functional life, and so on and so forth, right? Falling from grace. That is, we're not living out who we are, what we are, because of God's grace, so on and so forth, okay? So, we began looking at some of these specific provisions. The first provision that we learn about, notice there at verse 1 again, that all our fathers were under the cloud. So the first provision has to do with the cloud, and we won't go back there, book of Exodus or the book of Deuteronomy. The cloud was the dwelling place of God. The Lord would lead, guide, and protect the nation of Israel in this cloud of glory, okay? Again, our purpose isn't to study or examine the cloud, okay? The clouds are used a number of different ways in Scripture. But what Paul is referring to here is this, quote, Shekinah glory, it's called. There is this cloud of glory, if you will, that encapsulated the Lord Jesus Christ. And by the way, we know it's the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the pre-incarnate ministry of the Son of God in relationship to the nation of Israel. A theophany, it's called, okay? How do we know that? Look at verse 4. And did all drink the same spiritual drink, and they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was who? So when the Lord is talking to Moses, you know who that was? Pre-incarnate ministry, we now know it, know him to be Christ, okay? Our purpose is not to study the pre-incarnate ministry or anything like that. So just keep that in mind. The cloud, there was this glorious privilege, God dwelling with the nation of Israel, God dwelling among them. God literally in this cloud, keeping a watchful eye and leading the nation of Israel to a point where, you know, they're going to be delivered through the sea and so on and so forth, okay? And we there's a parallel that we can appreciate. And if you remember, go back to chapter 3 very quickly. Well, what do we know about God and where he dwells? Of course, he has a literal address there in the third heaven. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth where? In you. Go over to 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Now, notice 2 Corinthians chapter 13. And notice verse 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. By the way, it should, the emphasis is this. Prove your own selves. Look there at verse 3. Since ye seek a proof of Christ speaking in me. So guess what Paul does? You want proof Christ is speaking in me? He writes in verse 5, prove what? Your own selves. You know, here you are examining me. Well, wait a minute. Examine where you're at. You're not in the faith. Anyway, that's not our point. Keep reading. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is where? In you. Think about that. In time past, where was Jesus? He's in a cloud. Today, what does Paul say regarding where is Christ? In you, except ye be. Can we rightly say what we have is actually a bit better than what Israel enjoyed in the past? I mean, to have Christ leading in the wilderness is a tremendous blessing. But to have Christ in you, I would conclude that's a far better blessing, okay? I'm not saying we're better than it. All I'm saying is, what a glorious provision. Christ in you. Should we exercise liberty for our own self-gratification? You see? So just understand what Paul's seeking to do here. Go back to chapter 10 of 1 Corinthians. So the first provision regards the dwelling place of God in a cloud. We enjoy something far better than that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul goes on, and in verse 1, he adds, and all pass through the what? Through the sea. And God says to Moses, I'm going to show you the strong arm of the Lord. You, Israel, are going to witness my salvation. And you know historically what happened there at the Red Sea, right? Now, we have a parallel here that we certainly can appreciate. Here is a study for some future time, okay? Interesting. You have Israel escaping Egypt, a type of the world. But you also have Egypt, by way of escape, they're being led through the sea. There is a literal corridor in the sea. Now, be mindful. There is an invisible sea out in the universe. And we're not going to deal with any of this. But when you study something about the seas that are in the heavenlies. Now, here's an interesting parallel. Just as the nation of Israel, they found God miraculously provided this corridor through the sea. Well, you know that the church, the body of Christ, we're going to be going through the heavenly places. And you know that God, one day, he's going to open up a corridor. By the way, you remember what Paul writes to the Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Jesus Christ himself shall come down with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. There's going to be a similar event for the body of Christ where God is going to open up a corridor that allows us to pass through the heavenly places. So what we're not dealing with, all I'm saying is this. What a blessing, what a miraculous deliverance, the nation of Israel literally witnessing the strong arm of the Lord, the Red Sea, a wall on the right side, a wall on the left side, the ground was firm and hard like cement, and upwards of 2 million people. You know, there are different ways of calculating the potential number of Israelites, but perhaps up to, anywhere from 1 to 2 million, all right? So we'll go to the high side. Imagine 2 million people, not one of them got wet, and they passed through unscathed. And then you know what happened when the Egyptian army continued to follow and chase, and, you know, God then destroyed the Egyptian army. Okay, historically, you understand what it meant to be delivered through the sea. The third provision, verse 2 now, chapter 10. And we're all baptized unto Moses. They were not baptized into the sea. They were not baptized into the water. And just because we see the word baptism does not mean it has anything to do with being water baptized, whether it's by sprinkling, whether it's by dunking, The word baptize, just like the word salvation, just like the word justification, can mean different things depending on the context. Essentially, the concept of being baptized, it's to be identified into or to be identified with. This is the third provision that is given to the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel is identified with God's agent. Israel is identified with a specific authority, with a specific God-appointed leader. His name was Moses. If you want to know what Jehovah God, what the Lord wanted, what the Lord's expectations were, who was that agent? It was Moses, all right? What a parallel. If you think about that privilege of having a God-commissioned, appointed, authoritative leader, just like in time past, well, we have one in the dispensation of grace. His name is Paul, okay? Now, there's something we want to note when you go back to Exodus. Go over to Exodus chapter 14. Again, let's go back to Israel's history, the idea of being baptized unto Moses. Exodus chapter 14, just so we understand, verse 31. Exodus chapter 14, and notice there at verse 31. Verse 31, and Israel saw that great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians, and the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant who? Moses, okay? That's the concept. Baptized unto Moses. You can't deviate from Mosaic instruction. Well, should the body of Christ deviate from Pauline instruction? See, there's an important parallel here. The Corinthians unknowingly had a tremendous benefit. They actually had personal contact with Paul, the apostle of grace, the apostle of the Gentiles. They literally had the benefit and advantage of having God's divinely commissioned apostle minister in their assembly. And were they beginning now to move away? Now go to chapter 15 here in Exodus chapter 15. So Moses is the man. He's the man, right? Exodus chapter 15, and notice there at verse 24. Verse 24, and the people murmured against who? Uh-oh. Are the Corinthians beginning to murmur against the Apostle Paul? You know he is, okay? If we go back to 1 Corinthians, go over to 1 Corinthians, and if you go there to, again, chapter 9, we already commented on chapter 9, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and you remember there at verse 1, am I not an apostle? Verse 3, mine answer to them that do examine me is what? This. Paul knows what's going on there, okay? The Corinthians, they too were beginning to murmur, committing the same mistake Israel was committing. If you go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, and you think, okay, these dumb Corinthians murmuring against the Apostle Paul. Do you understand that that is a type and a foreshadow of the church, the body of Christ, murmuring against God by murmuring against the apostolic authority of the Apostle Paul? And there are a lot of churches meeting right now that unfortunately reject the idea or the clear teaching of Scripture that Paul was any different than the other guys. You say, wait a minute. You have to identify God's man, if you will. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, notice there at verse 2. Verse 1, do we begin again to commend ourselves? They're not doing it. Nobody else is doing it. What is that? It's a UFO. The guy who works for Northrop, he knows what's going on. See, he knows something about the deep state. There's something weird going on. All right. Verse 1, do we begin again to commend ourselves? You notice again, why is Paul always having to commend himself? Shouldn't, who, by the way, who did commend Paul? Jesus Christ. Wait a minute. Jesus Christ is the one who commended Paul. And so Paul's, again, defending himself, okay? Chapter 13, verse 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 3. And we already read this verse, but verse 3. Since ye seek a proof of Christ speaking in me. Okay, so the Corinthians, just as Israel was guilty of murmuring against Moses. And by the way, don't go back there to Exodus, but in Exodus chapter 16, you know what God said to Moses? Moses, if they're murmuring against you, they're murmuring against me. If you murmur against Paul, you're murmuring against the Lord Jesus Christ and his wisdom in appointing Paul as the apostle of the Gentiles, right? So just remember, there are some interesting parallels going back to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. So in Israel's past, their third spiritual benefit was, you want to know what God's doing? You go to Moses. And now you see Israel beginning to attack Moses. They begin to criticize Moses. They begin to murmur against Moses, and God took it personally, okay? Unfortunately, that happens even today in connection to the Apostle Paul. Verse 3 of chapter 10, and did all eat the same spiritual meat. Now, historically, what did Israel eat out in the wilderness? Okay, so just historically, let's go back to Exodus chapter 16. All right, go to Exodus chapter 16. Now, historically, they did eat meat. Interesting. It wasn't flesh meat. It wasn't animal meat. Now, there was a point in time where God did, the ravens and all that kind of stuff, okay? Paul calls it spiritual meat. And in fact, go to Exodus chapter 16. You know, I think it is important to identify this. Why? Paul didn't say, and they all ate meat. But what kind of meat did they enjoy? Okay? And then what kind of drink did they enjoy? Spiritual. So I just want you to recognize something here. Paul, going back to Israel's history, he isn't merely referring to the manna, although God did provide physical sustenance by way of manna. Paul calls it spiritual. And God did more than make water flow out of a rock. Okay, God did do that, but Paul calls it spiritual drink. So that to me is a key in understanding that there's more going on than simply whether it's manna or the ravens. There's more going on than water coming out of a rock on top of a mountain, okay? There's something more going on, which again, we see a parallel with what's happening in this current dispensation. Exodus chapter 16 there at verse 4, Exodus chapter 16. Let's go back to verse 2. Okay, go to verse 2 of Exodus 16. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full, for ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Isn't that a disgrace? But now notice verse 4. Then said the Lord unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather. And you know the rest of the story here, okay? Verse 31. Drop down to verse 31. And the house of Israel called the name thereof manna, and it was like coriander seed, white, and the taste of it was like wafers made with honey. And then, of course, there's instruction regarding the gathering and so on and so forth. Okay, this, by the way, is angels' food. Angels eat manna. Okay, so here's the point. There certainly was a literal, supernatural, physical provision for physical sustenance by way of bread, meat, raven, whatever it might be. But it's interesting that it's called spiritual meat. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy chapter 8. Is it an issue for God? I mean, could God take a rock and make bread out of it? So that's not the issue with the Lord, okay? there's something far deeper going on. There's something far deeper taking place. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. Is there a spiritual dimension behind the physical bread here? There's a lesson that God is teaching the nation of Israel. And that wilderness, there were 10 specific tests, okay? And they failed. Failed, check mark. Failed. And ultimately, 23,000 of them are killed. You know, God is not some capricious, arbitrary entity that the moment you provoke his anger, he takes you out. There are 10 deliberate steps of spiritual declension and spiritual failure until finally God now says, okay, enough is enough, okay? So, but anyway, the idea here in verse 3 is, okay, you know what the Lord's doing? I'm going to find out where your heart is. And the real issue isn't physical meat. What is the real spiritual issue? I want to know that, as the verse says there, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. You understand that? There is a spiritual meat that's actually God's word. It's the truth. And there are passages, go over to Jeremiah. Oh, drop down to verse 16. Just quickly drop down to verse 16. Who fed thee in the wilderness with manna, which thy fathers knew not, that he might humble thee, and that he might prove thee to do thee good at thy latter end. God was trying to educate his young child, and the child was resisting. Remember what Paul calls the Corinthians? Ye are still babes. He said, "Are ye not? You are carnal," and he calls them babies. Guess what's happening at Corinth as they're reverting back to Greek wisdom and philosophy and so on and so forth? You know what? They are ceasing the edification process. Here is God that's seeking to bring the Corinthians along through Paul and the doctrine committed to the Apostle Paul. Like Paul says, I'm the wise master builder. I'm the man for the age. And instead of the Corinthians valuing the ministry of Paul, they're turning away from him. And as such, they're cutting their training short. Instead of learning and growing and edifying and being taught and developing spiritually, just like Israel, they're failing. And they're cutting their training short. God's trying to test them. He's trying to prove them. He's trying to teach them some things. And instead of learning, they shake their fist against God. And they said, we liked it better. You see what's going on at Corinth? Instead of the Corinthians valuing the word and desiring to have some of the deeper, more advanced truths taught to them, they're saying, we liked it better in the world. You know, Socrates had a good point here. Human wisdom, that's why Paul dedicates 4 chapters going after the Corinthians because they were valuing human wisdom above the wisdom of Almighty God. But anyway, the idea of spiritual meat. Go to Jeremiah chapter 15. Jeremiah chapter 15. And then, of course, we'll go to Job chapter 23. Jeremiah chapter 15. Jeremiah chapter 15. And notice there, Jeremiah 15, verse 16. Jeremiah 15, verse 16. Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. Israel failed back there in Exodus. For I am called by thy name. Notice, spiritually speaking, yeah, God provides spiritual meat, and he wants the believer to eat it up. And what is that spiritual meat? It's the truth. It's the word of Almighty God. That was a lesson, by the way. The Lord Jesus, he succeeded with flying colors. Remember that? When Satan tempted him, you know, turned that rock into bread. And what did Jesus respond? He actually quoted Deuteronomy. He said, man shall not live by what? Bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Job chapter 23. Job chapter 23. The spiritual meat is far more important. And we're going to see the Corinthians. They missed it. At Job chapter 23, verse 12. Job 23, verse 12. Neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Over and over again, you find that God's word is likened unto food, spiritual meat. Now, you know, the precedent really goes all the way back to Genesis, right? Didn't God prove Adam and Eve? And remember what Eve did by way of subtle temptation? We understand that. She looked at that fruit. She said, man, pleasant to the eyes, makes one wise, and it was good for nutrition. And then they ate. They esteemed physical food more highly than God's word. And you know what God's word was? Don't eat it. Man, can it get any simpler? Can it get any simpler? Do not eat it. And they valued, she sadly valued, and Adam joined her, partnered with her. They valued physical sustenance over. So that's why in the Bible, God is always pointing out, listen, my words should be consumed. What I say to you is of utmost value. It's more important than just physical sustenance. Now go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. What's going on at Corinth? Again, a parallel that we want to recognize. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And verse 1, of course, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1. And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with what? Milk. And not with what? Meat. Now, you understand, again, there's a spirit. Paul's talking about spiritual meat. Not talking about physical meat. We recognize that because God over and over again identifies and describes his word as being spiritual food. Okay? What's going on at Corinth? They can't handle meat. Israel, they were valuing the flesh pots of Egypt. And by the way, you know that even when God did provide manna, you know what? For the first few weeks, this stuff is pretty good. And then what happens if you have a bowl of oatmeal? What if you have oatmeal every day for years? You get a little boring? So what did Israel do? They started complaining about the literal supernatural provision. And so anyway, Paul, when he says, verse 2, I have fed you with milk and not with meat. Listen, he's talking about spiritual meat. And the meat that Paul is talking about, it's quite obvious when you go back to chapter 2, verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. The meat that Paul is talking about is the advanced revelation that was given to him. That's the meaty stuff that unfortunately, and Paul even says, he says there, if you just glance back to verse 2, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Verse 6, howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the prince. So Paul is saying, listen, I have to limit my ministry to you. And basically, he's got to reteach some of the foundational truths that you would find in the book of Romans. And he's already, by way of rebuke, telling the Corinthians, I have this informational system called the hidden wisdom of God, but it's only for those who are perfect. That is, they're the ones that are growing and advancing in that system of revelation that was given to him. And the Corinthians, they're not ready for that. They just can't handle the spiritual meat. So here's a parallel. Did Israel enjoy not just physical sustenance, but didn't God also provide information to advance the place and of prominence that Israel was to enjoy as the head and so on and so forth? Yeah, they enjoyed God's word. Corinthians, they're not ready for the meat. They're still functioning, as Paul describes in chapter 3, as a bunch of carnal infants. And so Paul's got to change their diapers once again, okay? Paul's revelation is the meaty stuff. If you go real quickly to Ephesians chapter 4. So case in point, the Corinthians, my goodness, they enjoy some things, and yet they're not exploiting those blessings. They're not taking advantage of those blessings, just like the nation of Israel. Why? Because the Corinthians wanted their own liberty. They wanted to do what they wanted to do. They want to enjoy what they want to enjoy at the expense of what it is God wanted to do. In Ephesians chapter 4, if you recall verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine and so forth. Verse 15, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. The Corinthians, not there. Paul says, I'm not even going to try. I'm even going to waste my time with this. You know, we got to make sure folks are well established with some foundational truths before you start, you know, shoving some of the mystery truths, okay? The Corinthians just weren't able to handle it or digest that, okay? Go back to 1 Corinthians 10, and let's look at the drink, okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 10. The fifth provision or blessing, as we read verse 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 4. Now, notice, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, okay? Historically, go back to Exodus chapter 17. Go back to Exodus chapter 17. And notice what happened here, Exodus chapter 17. And I don't think we need to read. Oh, let's read verse 2. Yeah, let's read verse 2. Again, just think of the Corinthians a little bit here. Exodus chapter 17, verse 2. Wherefore, now let's read verse 1. Sorry, Rachel. Verse 1. She gets so mad at me when I do that. Isn't it fun provoking her? No. Verse 1. And all the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin. After their... looks like sin. It's sign, okay? After their journeys, according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink. Okay, so that's what God says, you know what? I'm going to deliberately make sure they die of thirst. Is that what God's intention is? Why would God lead them, by the way, into an area where there's no water? Remember, I'm going to test you here. I'm not just proving you. I want to teach you something. I'm going to teach you I am your provision. Okay, so there is a learning issue taking place. Verse 2, wherefore the people did chide with who? You see that? Wait a minute. Who? The Lord's the one leading, obviously through Moses, and the people did chide with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why chide ye with me? Wherefore do ye tempt the Lord? And the people thirsted there for water, and the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is this that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle? And verse 4, and Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, what shall I do unto this people? They be almost ready to stone me. And the Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people and take thee of the elders of Israel and thy rod wherewith thou smotest the river. Take in thy hand and go. Behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb. By the way, here we have the Lord is right there. And thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, and the that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders. So here we have the historic account of God supernaturally providing for the nation of Israel, because they're a bunch of crying, whining little babies making false accusations against God. By the way, does the body of Christ make false accusations about how God works today? God's teaching me something by killing my baby. How dare you accuse God of that? That's a false accusation. This event happened in my life because God is trying to punish me, chastise me, rebuke me, teach me. That's a false accusation that you're making of God. So again, the parallels, don't miss it. So historically, we see what happened in Israel's past, okay? But Paul doesn't just say they were given drink, i.e. water. They did. What does Paul call it? Spiritual drink. Well, we know there is spiritual meat, not just literal bread, but the Word of God, the truth. Well, so it is, there is a spiritual drink, and it's not limited to H2O. They got H2O, but there was something far more advantageous that the nation of Israel was to enjoy. Now, go back to Deuteronomy chapter 32, and just point out that the Lord was there. And Paul says, that's the rock. That rock that followed them, that was Jesus Christ. He's the capital R, obviously, rock. If you notice in Deuteronomy 32, verse 4, he is the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are judgment, a God of truth and without iniquity, just and right is he. Christ, again, pre-incarnate ministry within the ranks of the nation of Israel, he is there and he's following them. And they're following the rock, and that rock is Christ. He is there, okay? Now, what's with the spiritual drink? There's some verses. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 2. There are verses that describe spiritual drink, which is a representation, by the way. Now that summer is kind of winding down here, you know, you're outside, it's 100 degrees out, 100% humidity, and you're out there doing the yard work, whatever it is, and, you know, after a while, and you're sweating, you know, from the sweat of thy face, and after a while, you go for that, you know, cool bottle of water, and what happens when you drink that water? You know, it symbolizes this revitalization, it symbolizes this refreshment, it symbolizes life. Water symbolizes life, okay? So the Apostle Paul has some interesting things to say about spiritual drink as a representation of life, of functional life, of revitalization, of refreshment. And you'll find that, for example, Jeremiah chapter 2. If you notice in Jeremiah chapter 2, and I need to get over there. Verse 13, Jeremiah chapter 2. And verse 13, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living what? You know what God calls himself? He is a fountain of what? Living water. So wait a minute. Did Israel benefit from water, you know, pouring out of a rock? But who was there? Christ was there. And you know who Christ is? And of course, you remember the book of John. Christ is the source of what? Living water. Spiritual revitalization. Spiritual life. Functional life. Spiritual refreshment. That's the spiritual drink that God intended to provide for the nation of Israel. Not mere H2O. Verse 13 again. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters. And what did they do? And hewed them out, cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. Parallel. You know what Paul's going to tell the Corinthians? We've all drunk from the same spirit. So think about the Corinthians. They're making the same twofold error. They're not taking advantage of the spiritual drink, and instead of taking advantage of the spiritual drink, they're doing what Israel did. They've hewed out their own cisterns. In other words, what did the Corinthians do? They're going back to the wisdom of this world. They're doing the same thing. They're not drinking the spiritual drink. Rather, they're going to create their own man-made system intended to result in revitalization, refreshment. This old worldly viewpoint was viewed as though it is the means of satisfaction. It's the means of fulfillment. It is the means of purpose and meaning in life. The Corinthians are doing the same thing. Why are you going back to those old cisterns? Doesn't work. The wisdom of this world. Twofold evil. You reject the real deal and you fabricate a false system. That's exactly what's going on at Corinth. You got to appreciate why Paul is taking the Corinthians back to history. Go to chapter, we're still in Jeremiah, right? Chapter 17. Chapter 17. Jeremiah chapter 17. And notice there at verse 13. Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 13. O Lord, the hope of Israel, all that forsake thee shall be ashamed, and they that depart from thee shall be written in the earth. Shall be written where? Remember Jesus when he bent down and he started writing in the dirt? Now, I heard one of the best sermon titles. This is what I heard, and I really like it. When God gives you the finger. And it's a reference to the Lord Jesus. He with his finger, what did he do? Now, think about that verse. Verse 13, O Lord, the hope of it. And I'm not trying to be crude or rude, okay? God gave Israel the finger. He wrote some things. Verse 13, O Lord, the hope of Israel, all that forsake thee shall be ashamed, and they that depart from me shall be written in the earth. Here's an idea. When these guys wanted to stone that poor woman taken in adultery, remember what the Lord did? He didn't say anything. He started writing. What if he started writing their names down? Oh, Rabbi, I don't know, whoever. Rabbi, I was going to say Smith. Rabbi Mule, I don't know. I don't want to get into trouble here. So what if he starts writing their names down? Now, traditionally, everybody thinks he's writing down the Ten Commandments. By the way, we don't know. Well, we can infer, but the passage in John doesn't specifically tell us who he's writing down. I can't help wonder, these Jewish leaders, all of a sudden he's writing their names in the dirt, in the earth. And if any Pharisee and Sadducee and lawyer and scribe well-versed in the book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah 17 verse 13 says that God's going to write their names in the earth because they have forsaken the Lord. I just wonder if that's what the Lord is doing. He's writing their names down as hey, remember what Jeremiah said? I'm ashamed of you. And I'm going to put your name down in the dirt, okay? But anyway, that wasn't the purpose. Look at the end of verse 13. They have forsaken the Lord, the fountain of what? Living waters. Paul is talking about spiritual drink, the source of life functionally and you know, the vibrancy associated with it. Jesus Christ is our life. And the Lord, he a number of times, go to John chapter 4. Remember, go to John chapter 4. And there are a number of times where, you know, we can go to Psalms. We're not going to go all these verses. Psalms, Isaiah. A number of times the Bible describes living water. That's the real drink. Okay? In John chapter 4. Verse 10, John chapter 4, verse 10. Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldst have asked of him, and he would have given thee what? Living water. Israel enjoyed more than H2O. They enjoyed living water. Now, think about what Jesus Christ did. They demand water. So guess what the Lord does? The Lord, I don't know if he walks. I don't think the Lord needed to climb. So the Lord, he's standing on Mount Horeb. He is the rock standing on what? The rock. He is standing there as living waters. And Moses takes the rod, cracks it over the rock splits open, H2 comes pouring out. Just think of the irony here. Israel begging and pleading for that H2O so that they could enjoy life and be saved and revitalization. And Jesus is standing there and nobody's asking for him. He's the living waters standing. Can you imagine living waters looking at this stream gushing out of H2O? It broke his heart. Broke his heart. Okay, here it is. Go ahead. Drink. Drink. But I'm the one who gives life. And you're not interested. You're not interested in me. So Jesus, he says there at the end of verse 10, give me to drink. Thou wouldst have asked of him, and he would have given the living waters. And the woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. By the way, did that happen in Israel? Oh, they thirsted again. Here's the living water witnessing Israel's rebellion and unbelief. And okay, here's the H2O, and guess what? Tonight you're going to get thirsty again. Tomorrow you're going to get thirsty. But if I give you life, it's forever. Verse 14, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. Israel's training was cut short in the wilderness. Parallel, Paul had to cut short the Corinthian training. And you Corinthians, you need to learn something about Israel's mistake, lest ye also, go to chapter 7, lest ye also repeat that error. John chapter 7, and verse 37, John 7, verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Did Israel do that? You know what they did? They went up to Moses and they said, you led us here to kill us. Now, is that the path of faith or the path of unbelief? Verse 38, he that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of what? Living water. Oh, there is a spiritual drink. It's called life. God is called a fountain of water. Jesus Christ, he is the water. And out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Now, what's going on? Go quickly, 1 Corinthians. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And notice, and we're going to stop here, but 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. And did all drink the same spiritual drink? Now, we're not talking H2O here. They're actually participating in life that God, Jehovah, the pre-incarnate Lord, they're partakers of this life found in Christ at the time. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was Christ. You notice they drank. Go to chapter 12 and look there at verse 13. Chapter 12. And notice there at verse 13. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to what? Drink into what? One Spirit. The Spirit gives life, folks. And so the Bible, can a child, you see, a child only thinks of the manna. A child only thinks of H2O. But if you're a grown-up, you're going to find out, wait a minute, physical meat is a representation of spiritual meat. Physical drink is a representation of spiritual drink. Paul's writing to the Corinthians, they're still carnal, they're still babies, and he's sort of spoon-feeding them. Don't you know we've all been made to drink into one Spirit? He's the source of life and revitalization and service and function and so on and so forth. So, in short, you're right. I thought we were going to get down to verse 9, not even close. So we'll stop going back now to chapter 10. So verses 1 through 4, there is delineated for us specific provisions Israel enjoyed. And what happened? Verse 5. But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. If they would have had spiritual eyes, they would have seen what the Lord's doing and what he was seeking to teach and to achieve and so on and so forth. So instead of these blessings working, instead of Israel enjoying it, guess what happens? God's got to kill them. And we're going to stop. Paul now is going to start talking about, look at verse 6. Now these things were our examples. Do not interpret that to mean, well, if we don't take advantage of the spiritual provisions we enjoy in Jesus Christ, then God, He too will supernaturally punish us. He will supernaturally destroy us. Question. Did the threat of supernatural punishment, did the threat of supernatural destruction in Israel's day prevent them from being unfaithful? Did it work for them? Did God saying, Israel, you better walk the line or else? You better toe the line or else? Israel, you better obey or else? Did it work for Israel? They still messed up. So wait a minute. Why would God demonstrate Israel all of these blessings, but I'm not well pleased, and I'm going to 23,000 of you are going to die? And that threat of supernatural punishment now is the motivation given to the body of Christ. Lord, it didn't work for them. Why would it work for us? It can't. The threat of supernatural punishment doesn't work. So we're going to look at, why does Paul use language? Now look at verse 6 real quickly. Now, these things were our. Paul's talking about Israel. How do we know that? Verse 7, neither be ye. Verse 8, neither let us. Verses 1 through 6 is time past information that serves as an example to the ranks of the nation of Israel. Verse 7 and following, Paul is now referring to the Corinthians, and he's referring to the body of Christ. So we are going to need to learn something. Verse 11, now all these things happen unto them, Israel, for examples. And they are written for who? Our. Please, segregate. Always remember, don't get confused here. And why am I making a big point? Because some take the passage to mean, just like Israel destroyed just like God destroyed Israel, that's an example for you. Paul is saying, no, that's not an example for the body of Christ. That was an example for Israel. For us, it serves as an admonition. Verse 11, notice how Paul makes the distinction. A distinction without a difference, right? I'm kidding. Now, all these things happen unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition. An admonition, that it's a means of preventing error. Okay? So we'll focus on that a little bit more next time. Do not conclude, oh boy, if we screw up today, God's going to come down on us like a ton of bricks. Paul is not suggesting that, all right? So, well, here's your homework. Your homework is verse 9. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and were destroyed of serpents. Is it possible for you to tempt Christ today and God destroy you with serpents? I mean, let's really look at the pet. So here's your homework. What does it mean, tempting Christ? Can a believer today tempt the Lord Jesus Christ? And is Paul suggesting You do that, watch out, God will destroy you. Okay? Father, we do thank you for your grace and for your love. We do thank you for all that we have in Christ Jesus, the glorious spiritual blessings and provisions that have been secured because of the person and work of our dear Savior Jesus Christ. And may we also take heart knowing that just because we're in possession of all these blessings, it doesn't guarantee spiritual success in the details of life. May we certainly take the doctrine here in chapter 10. May it serve as an admonition. May it prepare us. And may we now exercise caution and care, guarding against making the mistakes that occurred in the past. We again thank you for your grace and how it is we're kept by it. We're sustained by it. We live according to your grace. And may we certainly always grow with the knowledge that we can never jeopardize our relationship with you. We just thank you for it in Christ Jesus.